Hi
Hey,
there.
David.
How are you?
Hey, good. How are you doing?
I just got some sort of notice from Zoom that I can use AI now. I'm like, why?
Oh my God.
Don't know
So
what it was. It kind of came and went, but apparently they're doing some kind of AI thing.
oh wow. I wonder what that even means. Like an AI version of you comes
Maybe, I don't
zooms
know.
with
I
me.
mean, put some makeup on or something. I'm gonna do it like a Zoom. What are those things they do on TikTok? I can put a,
Right. Yeah. You could put a filter. You could put a
yes, I can
filter.
put a
Yeah.
filter on. I think I could probably do that anyway, but I don't know what maybe they're new filters.
Right. Yeah.
Who's video filter? Let's see. I can put a, here's a
Oh,
pop.
there we go.
It's really important too. Yes, I can do
Yes.
a song.
Hey.
So yeah, I've got a 13-year-old boy, and I watched the movie again the last couple of days just to before we said hello, and
Yes.
I was like, man, it'd be kind of I kind of now wish my son would have a period.
So you could have that moment at the end.
Have that warm moment in the bathroom. Yes,
Yeah.
mostly
Do
it's
you
now
think
get out.
do guys have like an some equivalent moment to that?
I think it's when they
Like
discover
father
their penis
son?
does things that they that there's it's an
Totally.
immediate change of scenery. A lot more. We
Yeah.
actually have a little side thing on his door where he can put a do not disturb thing on there. So,
Right, yeah.
and
But
which of course my wife has
but
walked
your
in on
dad's not.
twice
Oh
because she doesn't even look at the sign. It's like the hallway's a little dark, so
no,
she's not really paying
oh no.
attention.
Yeah.
Just one knock and she's in, and it's like, honey, there's a
Yeah.
sign.
We have a system now. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So no
But
tears in the
no,
bathroom and they get
yeah,
all like, oh.
nobody's going to be brought to tears, though. No one's going to give him a hug after
No.
that.
It's not a traveling show for boys.
Yeah,
For women,
yeah,
it can
yeah.
happen anywhere at any time, even as
Right,
grown-ups.
yes, totally,
So
yes,
yeah,
yeah.
a little more complicated.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. Well, that's it. I think we're done. We're we covered the whole thing. So I
Yeah.
read this book at least 4 or 5 times when I was 10 or 11.
Did you really?
I have sisters only. I have three sisters, one of
Oh,
whom is my
so.
age. We're
Oh
6 years
my God. Okay. So everybody in your household was reading it, so then you
old.
had to.
Well, my other sister, two of my sisters are older, 13, 15
Mm-hmm.
years, and then I have a sister who is 6 weeks apart from me because of adoption. And
Ah, okay.
another Judy Blume book of some kind.
Yeah.
And so, yes, I knew everything. I read this book multiple times, and I read the Tampax box many, many times because we shared a bathroom and there was really nothing else.
Wow. Yes.
So I was ahead of the game as
No
well.
kidding. You were like schooled in all of this,
Yes.
totally, from a
Not
young
nearly as
age.
prepared as the girls in the
Yeah.
movie. Not freaked out by it. Was this a book of your childhood?
It was like passed around like a Bible. I mean, absolutely everybody read it. Everybody talked about it. It was like you couldn't get it at the library. Like it was always checked out. And the same thing with the book Forever. The other Judy Blume book that was like very, like risque at the time.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So did you have passages that you were like anxious to get to when you were adapting it? Were you like, oh, I can't wait to make that real?
Yeah. I mean, actually, I have to say the ending was like, I really, because that the ending was a lot of why I've like wanted to make the movie. I mean, I was so just, I don't know. I mean, it left me so emotional, and I swear to God, I felt like I was walking around for days, being like, "What happened to me? Like, why? Why did that make me so emotional?" You know? And so I think that's why I wanted to make the movie, because I want to get inside that and understand what that was about. You know?
And do you have kids? I don't know whether you have kids.
I do. I have. But I have a son. I have a 10-year-old son.
You have so much more fun to come.
Yes. Yep. We're right on the precipice of all of it. I'm kind of terrified because I feel like this is the best age. Like he's a full-blown person, but he is still just so snuggly and sweet and kind and holds my hand. And I know it's like a matter of, months that I have left,
I remember
So.
when I think when my wife first came out of the shower and encountered our son, and when he was probably 8 or 9, and was like,
Yeah.
that's not gonna happen anymore. Can't happen anymore.
Yep. Uh-huh. Yep. Yep.
All of a sudden
Yep.
is your
Yeah.
awareness of it being something other than, yeah.
Yes, totally. Yep. Yep. Totally.
Little
Yep.
surreal. So did you have that
Yeah.
experience with your mother? Did you have the Margaret experience with mom?
Not the way that it plays out in the movie, but I definitely did, I definitely did have I'd had that moment, but she played it really cool. She was trying really hard to be like, no big deal, blah blah blah, whatever. But what was so interesting is I just found out recently that actually one of my cousins was staying with us when she got her period, and apparently my mom like got her flowers and like did a whole thing. It was like a whole thing. So I don't know. So I'm like, wait, how come I didn't get that?
Interesting.
I don't know. Yeah. Or maybe she felt like it, I don't know. Maybe she felt like it was like too much. Like maybe she went overboard that time with my cousin. So she tried to play it cooler with me. I don't know exactly. But yeah, but I
It's a
remember it.
fascinating
Yeah.
thing. And in the
It
movie, one of the
is.
things that repeats is that the an in, instant call for mom
Oh
is the
yeah.
thing.
Totally. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. That's
Because at that age,
that's the instinct. That's the
girls
impulse.
could be a little, off their mom. And a little snotty,
Yeah.
and
Yep.
yet they turn into little girls as soon as they become women.
That's right. When you go through that, that's right. That's exact. I think that's perfectly articulated. You do. There's something oddly scary about realizing you've crossed that threshold. You know what I mean? Like I think I don't know, that was my experience of it. Like I was so desperate to grow up and to like and I was so desperate not to be a kid. But as soon as I crossed the line, I was just terrified and scared and wanted to run back, to just being a kid. It was such a soup of different emotions.
It is fascinating because it's, as I say, I have a 13-year-old, yours is 10. It's like
Yeah.
that whole thing of, wanting to release and wanting to be safe at the same time
Yeah.
is a, I guess we're going to go on. I'm going to get at least another 5 years of it. You, I can imagine, have 10 years of it at least, or whatever, 8 years.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. I'm nervous.
Yeah, we
But
actually went to a lecture on puberty just last night
really?
at the Willows. Yeah, it was my wife's birthday
Wow.
yesterday, and she decided that that's what she wanted. Her activity for the evening was to go to this lecture on puberty. I'm like, okay.
Wait. Hold on. This is what they do now? Like they
We're
have
not.
it.
It's
Wait.
schools. This is the Willows. They have a lecture series. It's a private school here in LA, which she works
Right.
out
Yeah.
of. And they had these two women wrote a book about puberty and do a podcast about puberty and blah, 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 blah. And the whole like they have a whole world of puberty going on in their world, and they came to talk
Wow.
about the things you encounter essentially and how to manage your
Wow.
kid through this situation.
So
And
it was a night, it was a parent's night. It was directed at the
yes,
parents. So it wasn't like you took your kid with you.
no, it was a not take your kid thing.
Got
And in fact,
it. Okay.
when I reminded my child that we were going, he was angry at me and I couldn't figure out why. And it was like he thought we were making him go. All he wanted to do was stay home and play video games.
Understand. I would be angry too if I thought
If
that.
he were there, he'd be angrier.
Totally. Yeah.
And of course, I was one of 10 men in the room. So, it was like 100
Right,
people came.
yes.
And I was one of 10
Totally.
fathers who showed up. The rest were all the moms.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, it was fascinating.
Oh my
But I'm
gosh.
not sure we can make a movie out of it.
I wonder why it was mostly the moms. Like that's a really interesting thing because I would assume the lecture was about both boys and girls going through puberty, right?
They actually talked about the fact that people talk to them about, they expect the conversation to be about girls, and they talk more about the boys than people expect.
Oh, interesting.
Well, of course, most of the boy stuff is about porn, so there you
Right. Oh.
go. They have all kinds of statistics about boys and porn, so I'm like, okay, great.
Oh my gosh.
But nobody asked whether
That's
girls watch porn at that
fascinating.
age, because I don't know the answer still.
Wow, that's really interesting. Yeah, I don't know either.
Yeah, but they were saying if your child is now 10 or 11, I think is the age, they have seen porn, is their feeling.
Oh my God.
And they said
I'm
even if
gonna
they
have a
don't
heart
have an
attack.
even if they don't have a phone, they've seen porn, so because their friends will
Oh
show.
my God. Oh my God.
Yeah,
Wow. Well,
so we
but
have
I
to.
actually remember, I remember being a kid. And there was always that one kid like on the street who was like, I've got an R-rated movie. And then, and like you'd be in their basement or whatever. And then they'd like pop it in and just fast forward to the part where you'd see naked people, and
Right.
you'll be like, oh. And then their parents would walk in and you shut it off real quick. Like, I totally remember that from that's like that is part of the coming of age experience, I
Yeah, Leah Thompson once in an interview, we were
think.
talking about it, and she said, actually, I don't know if she was doing it on camera, so I probably put that at her. She was saying, though, at cocktail parties, people come up to her and say, you were the first person I masturbated to. Because she was in
Oh
All the Right
God.
Thing with All the Right Things
Yes.
with Tom Cruise, and she does a
Oh
nude
my
scene.
God.
They have a sex scene. Mostly nude, but not, and they barely touch each other, but she does drop her clothes. And
Oh my
apparently, this
God.
is a coming of age moment for a lot of boys who are her age.
Oh my God. That is just
And she was like,
crazy. Oh my God. That
nice
is
to
so
meet you.
funny.
Goodbye.
Yeah. That's one way to break the ice.
Yeah, it's
Yeah.
a strange world.
Yeah, it
So
is.
how did this book end up coming to you? How did the idea of like doing a movie of this come to you?
Yeah, so really I was just thinking about what to do next after I made my first film, The Edge of 17. I sort of had this experience, which I think a lot of filmmakers have when you have a first film that is received well. It's sort of like a huge influx of different scripts and projects, and do you want to do this or this or this or this? And I kept feeling like I wasn't connecting deeply to anything that I was being sent. And so I spent like a year just like reading and passing. And then finally I was like, what am I doing? Like I have to just stop playing defense, and actually like play offense and
Were you scared that it
ask
would be
myself.
the wrong choice and that you would screw things up, or?
I actually have to say no, because when I did land on this, like I knew just everything in me. I knew this is what I was supposed to do. Like I just knew it. I knew this is what I wanted. I knew this is what I had to go after. And that was the thing that I was missing with all the things that were being sent. It's just like I
Right.
didn't have that thing where I had that like desperate need to make it. Which is, I realized something I have to make a film. It's just, it's too much of a, like a leave of absence from your life to not care that deeply, at least for me,
Right. Every
so
filmmaker is different this way.
yeah.
Yeah. So did you then bring Jim along, or was he already involved with the book or in some way, or?
Yeah, no. So then after I reread the book, I sent a letter cold to Judy Blume, knowing that she was never, ever, ever going to do this book. Like she had very clearly said, I'll open up my other books to be adapted, but not this one.
So
It's
this
off the
wasn't
table.
something where your agent said this book is in play, you should
No.
do it. You
Nope.
just,
Mm-mm.
you, how did you like run in, how did you think of the book? How did it actually come into your brain?
I was thinking about the things that most inspired me, and the first thing that came to my head was Judy Blume. I mean, she really was the first person who inspired me to read and then write. Before that, I didn't like reading. I didn't like reading before I read her books. Like everything that I was assigned in school, it felt like a chore to read. It felt really distant from me. And this was the first thing that felt like it was reflecting my own life back at me. And I was like, oh my God, this is like me. I didn't know books could be like this, and then I wanted to read everything that she ever wrote and was just like inhaling them over a period of a year or two.
This was when you were a
So
kid, yes?
this is when I was a kid, yeah.
But what
So
about when you were an
then
adult?
so yeah, so then one so then as an adult, I just was like, I was revisiting like what are the things that I have always really loved? And so I went back to square one, which was it was Judy Blume. So I went, Let me go back and just read some of those books. Like, why haven't any of those why haven't any of those books been adapted? And
Right.
so I went and started to reread them. And then when I got to this one, I was like, this, it has to be a film.
For me, it
So
was How to Eat Fried Worms. I read even more than I read the movie
yes,
that got it to me. But
I
the
just
movie,
read it to my son. It's so
really,
funny. Yes,
I used to read that book. Of course, I grew up without the internet or television. I had television, but I didn't have a lot of. But I read that book, like I could read it in one night or whatever it
Oh,
is,
yes.
hour. And
Oh,
so I read it
totally.
once a week. It was
Oh
just
my
like
gosh.
something to fill the
That's.
time. It was like a comic book or something almost for me.
Oh wow, that's so interesting. Yeah, I just read that book to my son like a year or two ago. Yeah.
Don't show him the
Yeah.
movie, it'll ruin it. But
Oh, really? I
I
didn't
don't
know
want to
they
say
made a
anything bad
movie.
about the director. I mean,
Yeah.
but you know, it was not a
Yeah.
great adaptation. For some reason, I don't know, it didn't fit my particular needs.
Didn't work. Yeah.
Didn't
Yeah.
work. So you got in touch with Judy Blume and
Yeah,
you
so I got
said,
in touch with her and yeah, and just wrote her an email cold and just said, said how much she'd influenced me, how much I loved her work, and that I really, really wanted to make this film and thought that it needed to be made as a film. And she wrote back. And then as soon as she wrote back, I was like, oh, wait a minute, this might be real. Because at that point I thought, she'll never write back. It's Judy Blume. So once she wrote back, I immediately called Jim Brooks and I said, look, you've got to read this book. I don't know if you'll get it in the way that I do because I so related to it as a kid, but please read it. And he read it that night and got it and really got it. I mean, I think to his credit. And so then the next thing I knew, we were on a plane within like days to go see her and try to like close it up, close the deal.
and she was game pretty quickly, or yeah, she seems like a
And
game
she,
person. I
yeah.
actually did an interview went back when we used to do interviews in person with her son
Yeah.
because he did a
Yes,
documentary about
Larry.
her, and I really
Yeah.
got you got the sense that she was like in for the game. She was ready to go.
She's a remarkable human being. She is just really an amazing person. I don't know. Yeah, she feels like a fairy godmother or something.
And so did she just she encouraged you to adapt it yourself as opposed to having her take a shot at it, or?
No, she was totally permission giving. I mean, really just gave her blessing. She was wonderful about it. But it was also important to me that she was involved, so she was on the set for a few weeks and when there were certain details, I would call her to to have her weigh in. I think she's a master of details, and that's part of why I love her work. Because I'm obsessed with details, especially like sort of messy, naturalistic ones. Like what to me, that's what makes something feel like life, and I think she's just a genius at those sorts of things. So having those conversations, having her on board to have those conversations, what felt like just such a boon.
Was there any one thing that she was particularly concerned with getting right, or?
Well, I will say, when the only time she spoke up on set was when I was shooting the scene, where the girls do, I must increase my bust. Because I was having them do it where they pressed their hands together and squeezed really hard. And so she shot out of her chair and it was like, they're doing it wrong. And so she came up and instructed us how to do it correctly.
I
But
always do remember. I
that was
remember
really,
that one from when
yeah.
I was 10 or whatever I was.
Yeah. Oh, totally. Everybody did it. Yeah. But since talking to a lot of people about it, a lot of people did it the incorrect way I did it. So, yeah,
Yeah.
because you're just imagining it when you're reading the book. But yeah.
I'm pretty sure it didn't work either way. So there you
Yeah, I don't know.
So you got it together, and you brought did so I guess going through your cast. Did you get the pre-Oppenheimer version of Benny, or did you get Benny post-Oppenheimer?
Oh my God, that's a really good question.
A slightly different performance.
I actually haven't seen Oppenheimer yet. I'm like
Oh,
dying
Benny
to.
is so good in it.
Oh my God, he's wonderful. I don't know whether he had shot that already or not. I have no idea. I have no idea at all, but But yeah, but I love that he's in this film. I think he's just so wonderful, and I love what a surprise it is that he's in this film.
The sweetness that you get out of him here is really lovely.
Yeah.
Again, which is kind of the opposite of the Oppenheimer work, which is breathtaking. You really should see it because he is amazing in it.
Oh, I can't wait. Yeah.
And McGay, seeing her back on screen after a while off, it feels like,
Yeah.
and how kind of just casually magical she is,
Yes.
kind of nice.
She makes it look so effortless, and I just she just like rips my heart out, like just every time I see her on screen. I think she's so she has such an incredibly unique ability to convey so many different emotions within like 2 seconds. You know, like it just all washes over her face, and you feel so many different things come through her. I don't know. I spend the whole time watching her just like choked up, also because I think she really conveys the complexity of motherhood and like what that has felt like to me. She conveys it in such a gorgeous way. She was just nominated for a Gotham Award
There
for the
you go.
film, so I'm so happy she's like being recognized, and her work in here is being recognized.
Yeah, she's one of the when she came up, it was like I thought I knew that she could be the biggest movie star in the world, and I think she kind of
Yes.
chose not to be. She's very
Yeah.
Canadian that way. But it's like it was kind of like nice to see her how just easily she slides into the character and just is.
Yes.
She's
Yep.
not trying. You don't ever see her acting it for a second.
No,
It's
that's
really quite
exactly right.
remarkable.
That's exactly right. It's just never a false frame. She
Yeah.
just is it. Yep. Yeah. It's really it's like watching magic. It feels that way to me.
Is it different when you get the footage back or when you look at the footage? Because I always get the feeling like she and the camera have a certain relationship that is beyond, you know, it's like has that thing, that magic thing.
Well, I mean, I, absolutely, she has. She's the camera just loves her. But I mean, I'm sitting there watching it on the monitor, so I'm experiencing it that way, you know, while I'm on set. So yeah, I feel like all I did was cry on set, and all I did was cry in the editing room. You know, I don't know. She just, I think she's just so remarkable. I really think she's one of the best actresses of our time.
When she and Ryan were together after The Notebook, it was like they were going to be Spencer and, you know, Hepburn and Spencer or Tracy and, or more so even because they were together. But then they just took off and stopped working for a year and a half. I was like,
Which I,
oh, okay.
yeah,
And I think
wait,
Ryan
which,
also just came to the point now in his career where he wants to be that guy. He's kind of
yeah.
avoided being a movie star in many ways, I think. And she certainly,
Yeah.
I think, did also. But I think it's time to now. She's ready to come back and take over the world.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, I think she's a person who just like, she's a deeply kind person, and she has her head on her shoulders, and I think she like prioritizes, you know, life over all of this, which I
Yeah.
think is the right way to approach all of it, you know. But she's just a deeply good human being. So whatever she does, whether she decides to like, you know, whatever she decides to do next, I'm on board for it.
And of course, I've been on board forever for Kathy Bates. Where did that come
Yeah.
from?
Yeah. You know, it was such a joy to watch her transform into this character, you know, because I think she's also a surprise. People wouldn't necessarily imagine her in this role. It was so much fun to be with her in the costume room. We got so lucky to have Anne Roth, who's just the greatest of all time, just the best costume designer in the world, put together her look. And it was so much fun to see like her walk in as Kathy Bates and look like Kathy Bates and talk like Kathy Bates and walk like that, and then suddenly put on the costume and the wig, and it was like everything changed. Her whole physicality changed,
Yeah.
you know. That was really exciting. It shows me how important that process is, that transformation that happens in the costume room for actors.
Well, for certain actors, it's like I always remember a conversation with Barry Pepper. He had done, I think it may have actually been the Haley Steinfeld movie in True West, True Grit. And he had talked about going into the costume room, and as soon as he put a certain hat on, he fit
Yes.
character instantly.
Yes. Isn't that interesting? Like it's weird how very often it's just one little thing that makes it click altogether. And I actually experienced that as a writer in a different way. It's like I'm always looking for the little thing that gives me a toehold, and then I know who the person is. But it's always, very often, it's the tiniest detail. And I'm like, I get you, you know? And I think, so I think, yeah, it's interesting to think about how the actors find that for themselves.
And was it easy, hard, fun dealing with so many young actresses on one show? Or actors too, young actors too?
Honestly, like a real joy. I love the energy on a set when you have that many kids on a set. You know, it's bananas, but in a great way. And I also, it's also exciting to me because I was constantly like pushing them to improvise and telling them, like, forget the words of the script, say it in your own words, or we're going to do it a totally different way, to just constantly keep them quick on their feet and keep everything fresh. Because I think, particularly with young actors, it's easy for things to start to feel stale, like once they've memorized it a ton. So it's constantly trying to, like, keep that out. But so because there was so much improvising and playing, that just kept a certain energy on the set that was really exciting. Like, for instance, when they in the scene where the girls look at the anatomy book and they look at the drawing of the penis for the first time, I just set up the camera, opened the book, and said, just react, just say whatever comes to your mind when you see this picture. And that's what you see in the film, is their honest to God reactions.
Well, the four girls are cast. They don't really fit together. They don't seem to be right together, and then they just are. It
Yeah.
somehow they seem like an odd group, a very eclectic group, and then
Yeah.
it seems like it just kind of got easier.
Yeah.
Clearer.
Yeah. No, totally. Well, I think they're each such like individuals as, yeah. Yeah,
Yeah.
they don't feel like each other exactly. They all feel very individual.
Well, you kind of expect the blonde to be the evil leader of some kind, Sprinter to be the what is it, the Heather,
Yes.
but she's
Yep.
not. He ends up being, vulnerable and not really tough at all.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite moments in the film when she breaks down.
Yeah, but even with her friends,
And
she's not like she's obnoxious. She's a little obnoxious, but she's not like she's in
she's
control.
not mean. She's
Yeah,
not mean.
she's
And
no mean
that's the
spirit.
thing. That's the thing. I actually think most, I think that's truer of the age. Like it's rare that somebody is overtly mean. However, I definitely remember at that age feeling there were certain girls that they could just with like the littlest pause or the way they looked at you, like you would just shrink. Like, yeah, for whatever reason, they just had this power. It was very, very subtle. But I also think even those girls are, just teeming with insecurity, as we all are at that age. It's just coming out in different ways,
At that age, this, I think it continues for quite. Sitting in that room last night, I saw all the insecurity of all the. Right, we were talking about how everybody was dressed, and you could tell like there were people who were dressing for success, going to a lecture about puberty. Like, okay, girls got to keep up, I guess. Or something.
Totally.
So, was there anything that you found hard to? Was there something anything you found hard to crack in terms of? Something that you loved from the book that you weren't quite sure how to write, or did it just flow naturally or easily?
I really wanted to make sure that the spiritual search at the center of it, her sort of existential searching, was delivered in the way that I felt it when I read the book. I felt her search as so sort of desperate and earnest, and just like really, really a child's like honest desire to know if there is something greater than us, you know, especially at a point in her life when she feels like the ground is shifting under her feet and she's not sure like if she'll be okay, you know, like I don't, there's something about that that really resonated with me when I reread the book. So I wanted to make sure that that came through, and that's a hard thing to, it's hard for me to even articulate it, you know what I mean? It's a feeling. It was important to me that that, you know, that very delicate thread was handled in a way that you could feel.
Well, the moment where she says, "I don't believe in God," after she's been said, as she continues to say, "Are you there, God?"
Yes.
is kind of
Yes.
lovely.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So
Yeah.
you get through it, you made it, you go into the cutting room. Was it, did it just, is, does it cut hard? Like, I remember Edge of 17 seemed like a more of a challenging cut. It seemed like it was, there were a lot of like angles to it and you know, complications, and this one seemed just more, a little more straight, or was it?
You know, I feel like you find the movie so much in the editing room. Like you figure out, you know, what you really need and what you don't and when you don't. So I feel like it's constantly like, you know, trying to just like cut away more and more and more of the fat until you have just sort of the essence of it. So I feel like that was the process with it, really just like finding its balance. With Edge of 17, it was more of a tightrope because it was more of a tightrope in the edit because I always knew that Nadine as a central character was going to be really tough because she's an asshole sometimes, you know, like, and then she's vulnerable and she's, you know, she's a lot of different things. And I knew that like you could only push it so far before we would just lose affection for her and stop rooting for her, you know? So I wanted to come right up to that edge and then pull back from it, you know, and then go right up again. And so it was, but I knew that that was all going to be something that had to be worked through in the edit, and that we'd have to feel our way through it and really just like measure our own emotional experience with the film again and again in different versions to feel like when we had hit it. So that one was, I would say, more challenging in that way, in that
Some
regard.
ways, Margaret is like a prequel, really.
I guess so, in
Or
some
could
ways.
be. Could be, could maybe not be, whatever, you know.
I guess so.
So you're going to go younger or older the next time, do you think?
Oh, I don't think I could go any younger than this. But
You have, I mean, have you figured out yet what you want to do, or are you kind of still looking for the next major inspiration?
I have, yeah, I'm in a writing period. So I'm in the middle of writing my next thing, and it's like exciting and terrifying. I feel like always being at the beginning of a creative process, I always find just wonderful and terrible, you know, because it's like like anything's possible, and oh God, anything's possible, you know. So
So besides the horror of it being a strike, did the writer strike work for you? Did it give you space to
you
go?
know, I it actually did. It was you know, I think if there's anything, if I got anything positive out of it, what it was. It was just a chance to like think in the quiet, and stuff like that. But I'm
A
sure
lot of
glad it's
writers said
over.
to me, told me that they wrote more in the first 2 months of the writer's strike than they had written in years, because they had time to
Right.
just write and not
Right. Yeah.
do all the other stuff of
Totally.
production and all that. I think
Yep. Yeah.
by month three, they were a little tired of
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Totally.
was time to
Yeah.
get back to official work.
Totally, totally. Yeah. And I mean, and the hard part about it too is just like all the other people like held hostage by the strike. That part just you know. So all the other people that have nothing to gain from it, that are just like, you know, that work in the industry, the craftspeople and stuff like that, like couldn't work. So that part was just, you know, that's just, it's tough, very, very tough. But I don't know. So I'm glad one's over, and hopefully the other one's getting wrapped up soon too.
So I would ask this question of a man, and in fact, I find it more interesting sometimes with the guys. But do you pace your work? I mean, the choice to make a movie, certain space and time and everything else, and you're parenting a child, still a child. Is that part of it? Is that just, have you kind of made it into a lifestyle in terms of, okay, I'm not rushing to make the next thing in 6 months or a year or whatever. Does that all work for you? Have you figured out, is that what works for you as
You
such?
know, yeah, that's it's an interesting question. I got sort of lucky on this last one because I made the movie in North Carolina for 6 months, and it was during the pandemic, so my son could come with us, and he was on Zoom school, you know. So if there's one sort of silver lining of the whole thing, it was that he didn't skip a beat, you know. All
Right.
his friends were in Zoom school. The next time around, I don't know.
What was
But
that like shooting a movie? You shot during the pandemic still?
yeah.
So it was still COVID-y and masks and all that stuff,
Oh
and then
yeah.
took them off just for the shots?
Yes.
How
Yep.
hard was that?
Tremendously hard. Well, first of all, like it's hard to make a movie, period, you know, because you're up against the clock and all the things. But then when you add all of these other protocols, it's, you know, it's tough. And then and some of it sort of feels like theater, because it's like, really, like we have our masks on, but then, you know, like the minute the camera rolls, we take it off, and that's fine. Like it so it's a, like some of it was a little silly, some of it was helpful, but anyway, but we got through it somehow, you know. Yeah, we got through it. It's like, by sheer force of will, you just get through it. So
Had you started before it started, or do you actually start production in the midst of it?
we had just found our Margaret, and we just found Abby, and then, like,
And you were on the
I don't
clock.
know, two like yeah no and then like 2 weeks later, the world was shut down.
Wow.
So yeah, so then we didn't make it for another year, which was just terrifying, because it was also like, the kid's gonna go into puberty, like,
She's
you
gonna
know,
get her
like, oh
period.
God. Exactly.
Wow. So you were kind of like up against the end of her viability as a Margaret at
Oh, well,
the
no.
shot.
Well, also because the whole movie is her like praying for boobs, and it was terrifying thinking it was going to
God
look like
forbid.
God had answered. And then actually it did. She showed up in the conference in the costume room, and she had hit puberty. So we spent like a lot of money visual effectsing
Wow.
her chest, to flatten her chest all throughout the film.
That may be the first and last time it ever happens in Hollywood.
I'm telling you, exactly. I really think so. I think we set some sort of record.
It's
I
usually the
feel
other
like I
way
need a
around.
plaque. Yeah, exactly.
I will quickly tell you the story of when I was a child writer, and I was working for a guy named Chuck Freeze, who was a mostly in television guy, but he was trying to do movies. And we made a movie, and it was with a great actress named Fabiana Udana, who was an Italian girl who was very prodigious in the breast area, and that's why they hired her, because she was very, very
Yes.
sexy. And so there's a
Yeah.
sex scene with her and Bruce Boxleitner, of all people,
Huh.
and she takes off her clothes, and she we paid her to show her their chest, as you do in
Yes.
the movies, and she
Yes.
ducks and she lies down. And she's got, D cup breasts, and they move a little to the side. And we're showing it to Chuck for the first time, and he's like, "What is that? What is that?" He had never seen real breasts that size. He'd only seen breasts with implants that
Oh my
size.
God.
So it completely freaked him out that the breasts were moving. And we actually had to cut around her natural, beautiful breasts. And we could only have shots with her like this. Because
Oh my
he thought it was
God.
incorrect to have breasts that
He was
actually
like,
moved.
this is not right. I've never seen ones like,
He
oh
was
my
shocked.
God.
He had seen
Oh
breasts
my
that size, they
God.
just weren't real.
Yes, right,
So
totally.
they stayed for.
Oh my
So yeah,
God.
that's Hollywood's idea of how to manage.
That is, oh my God. Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh my God. I love that he said that's incorrect. That's
He was,
incorrect.
and literally, he made us cut around them. We had paid $40,000 or whatever for her to do this in this
Right,
probably
yes.
low budget movie, and
Right, yeah.
we had to cut.
Oh my God. Oh, that's so
So
funny.
that will never happen with James L. Brooks. So I don't know if James L. Brooks
No.
has ever had any nudity in any of his movies ever.
Yeah,
So
that's a good question. I don't think so. That's a good question,
there's a
yeah.
shot in I'll Do Anything, which I've never seen. I've always wanted to see the musical version.
I know, yes, everybody does,
Driving me
yeah.
crazy, but there's a moment where Albert Brooks is in bed with Julie Kavner. He starts to get out and he's naked. Apparently, they had sex right before that or whatever. And I was like, no, I don't want to. The one thing I love Albert Brooks so much, I do not want to see Albert Brooks naked at all. Don't do this to me. And they didn't. He cut away. But I was like, oh man, that was a scary movie moment for me.
Oh my gosh, that's so funny. I would love it if Jim Brooks, like one moment of nudity in all his films, is just a full frontal of Albert Brooks.
Oh, are very few. I mean, Albert's, it's not like he's an unattractive man. He's just
No, but
very
yeah.
hairy. Is like, it's like the creature from Black Lagoon or something, but with hair. Anyway, on that strange note,
My
this has
gosh.
been, it sounds like this box office, I think people were hoping maybe a little bit more, kind of like with a
Yep.
17, but
Yep.
there's definitely a following that is in love with this movie still.
We're picking up picking up our steam. So
Good.
and that's the thing. Like with Edge of 17, it was like it was amazing. It was like as soon as it hit Netflix, it was just like wildfire.
Yeah. Well, I think my interview with Haley from that is still like one of the most popular ongoing
Is that
interviews,
right?
whatever it's been 5 years or whatever.
No, totally.
Of course, my favorite was with Jim Brooks, who told me I was like a Nazi therapist. That it was the most pleasant, unpleasant experience he had ever had. I mean,
Oh my God.
putting him on the therapy chair. But I love James Brooks, so it's like
Yeah, me too.
it's one of those, he's one of those guys who just the entire history of show business goes through him.
It really does.
Yeah.
And he's one of those people that they say don't meet your heroes, but you meet him and you're like, damn, you are everything I wanted you to be and more. You
Yeah.
know?
It's a nice thing.
It really is.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you so
I did
much.
take my 13-year-old, then probably 12-year-old son to see the movie when it came out. We actually went to the movie theater together, my wife and myself and my kid. So
Oh,
he wanted to
cool.
go. We didn't have to force him.
Wow.
So
Wow.
I guess maybe he just takes after his dad. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I don't know if he
Yeah.
actually learned anything because he's still a 13-year-old boy, but
Right.
hard to get in there.
Right. No, totally.
But I think he
Totally.
figures
But
it
I'm
all out.
impressed. I'm impressed that he showed up at all.
Yeah. Well, he loves Rachel McAdams. No, I don't think. I don't even know if he knows who Rachel McAdams is. That's the scary part. It's like my entire history, you have to kind of like, but it's amazing with the kids. They go on streaming, everything's a meme. So like he
I
knows
know.
like theme songs from TV shows and movies and whatever from the 70s and 80s that I'm like, he starts singing along if it comes on the radio. And I'm like, what is, how do you know
You're
that?
like, how do you know that? Totally.
It's an
You're
interesting.
right. It's the memifying of
Yeah.
everything.
Yeah. Now we just have to get him to watch, he actually liked Oppenheimer 3.5 hours long, so he did okay with that. But yeah, getting that focus past 20 seconds or 2 minutes or whatever is the, I guess, the challenge.
Yeah, totally, especially these days.
Yeah. He's concerned for his generation. Every once in a while, he points out that his generations may be in trouble because their attention span is so short. So,
Yeah, you do wonder how it's all gonna play out, but yeah. But everyone always worries about the next generation, so I don't know.
that's true. And we always had the best generation. Whatever generation
Yeah,
we're in,
exactly.
that was when it was perfect.
That's exactly right.
Yeah. Except we didn't have cable. We didn't have, well, I'm like, see, I'm probably 15, 20 years older than you. So, yeah.
When were you born?
64.
Okay. I was 1980.
Yeah. So you're a kid. That's what I'm hit that age where I'm supposed to say, you're a kid. So there you go. Well, thank you very much. It was lovely chatting. And I'm glad things are moving along. And I guess we're rooting for Anne Roth and for Rachel. publicists are, and for the whole
Yep.
thing. But you know,
Yep. Yep.
going to
Yep.
push it up the
Absolutely.
hill, push the ball up the hill, push the roll up the ball up the hill. And
Yep.
everybody deserves
Yeah.
everything. It's
Yeah.
like a movie made of love.
Yeah, it really is. It really is. Yep. Yeah.
Have
All
a good
right.
one.
Thank you
Thank
so
you so
much. I
much.
so appreciate it. So
Absolutely.
appreciate it. Thanks
Take
so
care.
much.
Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye.